We would appreciate it. If you'll take your Bibles and open to Genesis chapter 41. Genesis chapter 41. We got up to verse 45 last Sunday. We've been looking pretty hard at undeserved suffering. In the first part, from verse 1 up to about where we are now, we have Pharaoh, the Pharaoh of Egypt, explaining to Joseph what his dream was about. No one else could interpret it. And so Joseph interpreted it, and first thing he did was give the credit to God. Pharaoh was thinking that Joseph himself could interpret it, and he said, no, that's God's job. We need to remember to do that the same way as always, give credit to God. And so then he interpreted the dream. It had to do with a famine that was coming that would be probably the mother of all famines. There was going to be 7 years of plenty, to where the Pharaoh and Egypt, through Joseph, would be able to prepare for it. There would be more abundance for the first 7 years. And then at the end of those 7 years, it would be completely stopped and a famine would hit. Can you imagine a 7-year famine? And so they would have to rely on the food that they had stored during the good times to make it through the bad times. And so we also see that Pharaoh was so thankful, and he saw that this was a man that was different than most men. Indeed, he was. And that God was using him in order to bring this about. So he started giving him gifts and accolades and put him as number 2 in the kingdom. The only person that had any more authority than Joseph was Pharaoh himself. And so when we start verse 45, it kind of connects to that portion of all these things that Pharaoh is doing for Joseph. So we look at verse 45. It says, then Pharaoh named Joseph Sphananath Paneah. And the best that they can tell what that means was God speaks. And he gave him Asthenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, and his wife. And Joseph went forth over the land of Egypt. Now, there's a lot more to this verse than what might meet the eye there. What Pharaoh was actually doing was Egyptianizing Joseph. If you're going to be number 2 man in the kingdom, then you would think, well, you better look and act and speak like someone that is Egyptian. So the first thing he did was change his name, because the name he had certainly was not Egyptian. How many of you know who Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah is? Anybody know who they are? Raise your hand if you do. That many? Wow. For the rest of you, you'll recognize them as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And the names Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah were the Hebrew names. It's funny that everybody remembers the Egyptian names. So they had something in common with what happened to Joseph, and that was their names were changed. And that's a big deal. I think I'll show you on the board. This is what I'm looking at. Daniel's name was changed as well. Here you have at the top Daniel. Daniel's name meant God is my judge. And his name was changed to Belteshazzar, meaning to save the king's life. So that's the name that was given to Daniel. Hananiah's name meant Yahweh is gracious. And his name was changed to Shadrach, which means command of Aku, the Sumerian moon god. And then you have Mishael, whose name means who is what God is, changed to Meshach, who is what Aku is. That's a pretty little sleight of hand there. And then you have Azariah, and Azariah's name was changed to Yahweh has helped, and it was changed to Abednego, and that means servant of Nego, and that was a Babylonian deity. And that was what their names were going to be from that point forward. So, what we need to remember is that we think with words, don't we? And whenever you change the meaning of words or change names and so forth, then you change the way people think. And there is a lot of name changes and changes that are going on these days. So the reason we have so many name changes today is because there are those who are trying to change the way we think. And political correctness, sometimes called PC, I was going to look up PC on the internet for politically correct, and it came out with personal computers. So I had to go another direction. So I'm going to give you a few examples of what PC, politically correct poison, is doing to us, and how just the changing of names or changing the meaning of words can have great impact. And I don't think any of us want to endeavor to be politically correct and have all the right sayings. But nearly all of us do adopt these terms and these names because you hear it all the time. So I'm going to go through a few of them to give you an example. The first one is global warming. You all remember when it was called global warming? I think they figured they had to change the name because Al Gore was going to a global warming meeting. It was a conference, and they had to cancel it because there was too much ice on the roads and it was too cold. That would be a little embarrassing, wouldn't it? So they changed the name to climate change. Climate change. They think they can control the climate. Who is it that controls the climate? Everybody's going like this. Jesus Christ on the Sea of Galilee pretty much demonstrated who controls the climate, the weather. Remember, he was in a boat and the big, huge storm came up and he was asleep. They had to wake him up and say, "We're going to all drown." And he stood up and said, "Be still." Those great waves and everything that was going on was like a glass. So that's one of them. The next one is semi-automatic rifles are now called assault weapons. So, you all know what a semi-automatic weapon is. It's a kind of weapon that you can pull, keep pulling the trigger, but you have to pull the trigger every time. That's why it's semi-automatic. And automatic, you just pull the trigger and hold it and just keep shooting. Of course, most of the people that are trying to do away with these rifles, mainly the AR-15, don't have a clue what semi-automatic weapons are. So they call them now assault weapons. And I'm thinking, you know, they're trying to put a bad spin on that. But we could turn that around and say, yes, it is an assault weapon. So anytime some criminal tries to assault us, then we have the assault weapon to take care of that. The next one is husband and wife. Anybody know what husbands and wives are called now? Partners. And people, see, I'm not around a lot of young people anymore. And I guess they say partner, but whenever somebody says, have you seen my partner? If it's a man, I'm not, I don't know what he's talking about. Is he talking about his business partner? And see, partner means two things. First of all, it can mean you're not married at all. Marriage is out. Partners are in. And it also can hide whether it's a male or female. There's a lot of thinking that goes into these name changes. The next one is chairman. You know, a chairman is the guy that is conducting the meeting, whatever it is. And so now, chairman is a chairperson or a chair. How ridiculous is that? I don't know which one of those terms is worse. You go up to someone, you say, who's in charge? Or are you the chairperson? Well, either it's a chair or a person. Put them together, it doesn't make any sense. Or just say, have you seen the chair? Yeah, it's right there. This just gets under my skin. The next one is homosexual. You hear very few people say homosexual anymore. And now, of all words, it's gay. There's nothing gay about homosexuality. Nothing whatsoever. And yet, most of us have adopted that, and I'm making a concerted effort. I'm not going to say gay. The Bible doesn't even call them homosexuals. You know what they call them? Sodomites. And by the way, if you want to call them that, you have the liberty to do it, and it's biblically correct. If they vibrate, that's on them. The next one, you're going to like this one. The next one is prostitute. Can you ever think of what the politically correct term is for prostitute? Sex worker. Or sex care provider. Dishonest is called ethnically disoriented. A person that is dishonest, he's not just a liar. He's not just a sorry person. He's ethically disoriented. I think whoever gave us this name was disoriented at best. Illegal alien is an undocumented worker. Oh, boy, you're going to like this one. Guess what the politically correct term is for fat? Are you ready? Metabolic overachiever. I'm not fat. I'm a metabolic overachiever. Right-wing protests are called riots. Left-wing riots are called protests. A housewife is a domestic engineer. The crime rate is referred to as street activity index. A wanted criminal is called a person of interest. I've heard that one before. A person of interest. Christmas is a winter festival. Shoplifting is irregular shopping. Failure is non-traditional success. And lies, this is the last one, is alternative facts. So when you tell somebody a lie, you're not lying to them. You're just giving them alternative facts. And, of course, all this is nonsense and gibberish. In our time, names are being changing so rapidly. They're changing in sports. Does the... What is it? The Kansas City Chiefs, is that who it is? Or the Washington Redskins? And the Native Americans like that because it's showing that they're proud enough of the Redskins to name their team after them. Of course, everything gets upside down. Schools, military bases, businesses, TV commercials, libraries, and parks have all been changing their names in order to comply with the PC mob. These are just a few of the political correctness examples, but they show how long and how hard they work in order to change our thinking. Even though, obviously, for any person who has any sense can see that the changes are absurdly ridiculous, and yet people are starting to use these terms. But I'm not going to. I'm not going to purposely do it, and I hope you don't either. The English language is great because it allows every person to communicate in a very vivid and clear way. Whatever we want to express, we can express it because we have a phenomenally expressive language. And for someone to come in and start saying, no, this is wrong. You can't say lie. What was the lie? It was alternative facts. That's rubbish. So far, there's no legitimate laws that have been passed that require us to adopt political correctness, which would neuter our language and destroy our freedom of speech. Politically correct is being used as a weapon against us to force us to conform to the insanity of the diabolical leaders who are trying to abolish our freedom and destroy our country. That's how serious this is. And that's essentially not on the same level that I'm speaking of, but that was what you have Pharaoh doing to Joseph. I don't think that Pharaoh was doing it in an evil way. But if you're going to be the number two person in the kingdom, you have to look like an Egyptian, speak like an Egyptian, and then he's going to have an Egyptian wife. All these things. He really liked Joseph, so he wasn't doing it. But still, what my point was, when you start changing names, you start changing the meaning of words, it changes the way people think. And over time, you adopt them, you get to the point you can't even remember what they were before you started getting into the PC crap. So I say shame on those who have banned books such as Tom Sawyer, Gone with the Wind, the books of Dr. Seuss, To Kill a Mockingbird, and many other classics. They've been killed because of the poison of the PC. You can't get them anymore. And I say, shame on those who are complying with that nonsense anyway. Okay, now, let's look at, again, verse 45. We have Joseph marrying an Egyptian wife. Joseph's wife's name literally means the servant of the goddess Neith, capital N-E-I-T-H. Her father's name, Potipharah, capital P-O-T-I-P-H-E-R-A, is a proper noun meaning he whom Ra, capital R-A, the sun god has given. So she's really royalty. She's high in the social status. Potipharah was a priest of the sun god Ra at On, O, capital O-N. If someone was talking to you and you were from On and you worship the sun god Ra, someone could say, where are you from, On? Who you worship, Ra? Doesn't have much to say, does it? On was Potipharah was a priest of the sun god Ra, and On was situated 7 miles northwest of modern Cairo and was famous for the worship of the sun god Ra. Now, some of you may be thinking, now wait a minute. I thought that the Old Testament and the Mosaic Law forbid the Israelites from intermarrying with Canaanites and pagans. Anybody been thinking about that? Well, I can understand why you would, but I'm going to give you 5 reasons that would maybe mitigate if you think that he was doing something wrong. So these are 5 reasons. So see, when we're studying something like this, and it doesn't say anything about God saying this was wrong, but you do know about marrying those who are unbelievers is wrong, even in the Old Testament especially. Point number 1, Joseph could not go back to his people to marry a woman who was an Israelite. So if he was going to be married, it'd have to be to an Egyptian woman. 2, marrying someone who was a Canaanite was prohibited, but Egyptians were not descendants from Ham's son Canaan. Now specifically, in Genesis, what we've been finding is the Israelites were prohibited from marrying Canaanite women. You just weren't to do that. But Egyptians were not descendants from Ham's son Canaan, so they weren't Canaanites, so that prohibition did not necessarily stick. 3, in Joseph's day, God had not yet given any commandments regarding marriage, but later in the Mosaic Law, God did forbid marriage to the Canaanites. And this is what so many people do. This is one of the most prevalent mistakes, people make, and that is taking something from another portion of the Bible, from another dispensation, and trying to make it related to here and now. And that's what people do here. So the Mosaic Law hadn't even come yet. Moses yet was not born. And so that cannot apply to this situation. 4, the fact that the Holy Spirit saw fit to have Moses' record name Joseph's Egyptian wife also implies she accepted God by faith, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And here's why. The fact that she is named could strongly suggest that she was a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, if you, even in the Mosaic Law, if you married a foreign woman that was a believer, that was okay. So this kind of leads credence that she was a believer. And I don't think that Pharaoh would offer him a wife that he knows would be displeasing, because Joseph did not compromise when it came to serving God. And if he wouldn't do anything that would displease God, And so it strongly suggested that she was a believer. If you'll remember in Genesis chapter 48, that Judah, remember when Judah just went off the cliff and he married a Canaanite woman? Well, that Canaanite woman, what her name was not given except in, I think it's 1 Chronicles 13, I don't remember the chapter. Anyway, in 1 Chronicles, she is named in a list of genealogy, but she is not named particularly like Joseph's wife is, because I think it's because she was an unbeliever. She had to show up in the genealogy, but she was not mentioned directly like the wife of Joseph, so I think she was a believer. So why did it give you all this information? I mean, it's okay. It's nice to know these things, but here's the point in giving you this information. We must check all the facts pertaining to a verse before we can answer questions about that verse with any certainty. We're quick to just, you know, okay, the Old Testament believers were not to intermarry. They weren't to marry unbelievers and pagans, so it has to apply here. So what Joseph did was wrong. That's what someone would do if they didn't look at all the facts. Look all over the Bible. See, in the ICE method, isagogical, categorical, and exegetical, the C there stands for categorical. That means when you go to a portion of Scripture and you're on a particular subject matter, you just can't look in one book and find that and say, oh, okay, well, that's what it means. Well, maybe, but the circumstances might demand that there are other things that would impact that verse. So you have to go all over looking for all the facts before we can now say this is wrong or this is right and say it with confidence. Okay, verse 46. Now Joseph was 30 years old when he stood before Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from the presence of Pharaoh and went through all the land of Egypt. So, how old was Joseph when he was enslaved? 17. And now he's 30. So he was approximately 13 years as a slave. 13 years he was suffering undeserved suffering. And I'm sure over the years he had numerous opportunities to doubt God's faithfulness and devise a plan for his future himself. Would you? 13 years passed and you're still a slave? You remember the dream back there when God presented to you in a dream that your older brothers, all your brothers, your father and mother, all were going to be bowing down to you. He probably hung on to that. Well, no doubt he did. But what I'm saying, there was always the temptation to say, now look, I've waited long enough. 13 years, I'm not going to wait any longer. I'm tired of waiting on God. I'm going to take the bull by the horns. I'm going to do this myself. I'm going to devise my own way. And y'all are looking at me so innocently. What is he talking about? Y'all know what I'm talking about. We've all done it, haven't we? What happens when we take measures into our own hands? We're not waiting on God. I'm through with God. He's not going to come around. I'm just going to take it for myself. How does that end up? Not so well, does it? We can see it throughout the Scriptures. David was a master at that. David was, when he was good, he was really good. When he was bad, he was really bad. But he knew how to acknowledge his sins. So 30 years is a long time to wait on the Lord, but it's always worth it. Remember that. Turning your back on God and trusting in yourself never turns out well. Verse 46, and Joseph went out from the presence of Pharaoh and went through all the land of Egypt. That's a little tidbit there. What does it mean? What it meant was he had a crushing responsibility on himself. Thousands, hundreds of thousands, I don't know, maybe a million people or more, was going to be dependent on him getting the job done. Now, God said that he is going to, the famine is coming, and Joseph is the man of the day. He's going to take care of it. Now, a lot of people would think, okay, well, he has a title, and a lot of people act this way. Number two in command. Everybody had to bow down to him. Everything was great. And you think he would strut around, and he'd have all his underlings take care of things. How do you think that would work? So he went out to all the cities in Egypt, and he saw what they had, how they operated, the people that were there that he could trust, those who had character, those who are going to follow orders. He was going through there and making this consensus of what everything was like. So when this famine hit, he would know where to put certain people here, certain food over here. He had to have it people that he could trust that was going to defend that food. All of that was there. So I guess this verse, if you want to just mark in your Bible what this last part of this verse is about, is hard work is necessary. Even when God is going to use you and he has empowered you and you are fulfilling his plan, it's not that you can sit on the porch and eat bonbons. You have to get out there and work. Sometimes we think, oh, well, God's going to take care of it. And you have people thinking somebody else would do it. God's relying on us to do it. And that's what Joseph is doing as he goes out and about. As we go to verse 47, let's read 47 and 8, and I have a quote for you here. Verse 47. And during the 7 years of plenty, the land brought forth abundantly. So he gathered all the food of these 7 years which occurred in the land of Egypt and placed the food in the cities. He placed in every city the food from its own surrounding fields. So I have let's go and do 49 as well. Thus Joseph stored grain in great abundance like the sand of the sea until he stopped measuring it, for it was beyond measure. Now some say that he stopped counting because the Egyptian counting, they only had their numbers only went so high. For the Greeks, it was about 10,000. That was their highest number. Sometimes they say 10,000s of thousands, something like that. What it was, he could not even keep track of it. It was so abundant. But Henry Morris, in his Genesis record, the Genesis record book on page 584, says the following. Henry M. Morris has an excellent comment. He writes, quote, "It would be necessary to levy a double tax on the produce of Egypt during these years of plenty." Now, 20% would be one-fifth. Remember when Joseph was talking to Pharaoh after he interpreted the dream, and then he says, now this is what you need to do, Pharaoh. You need to take one-fifth of all the produce, all the food that comes in, and you need to store that. I mean, he didn't even hesitate. He went right from the dream of interpreting it to telling Pharaoh! What he needs to do. Now that's somebody that's in charge. That's somebody that's confident. His confidence was not in himself. It was in God. And so what I'm saying is the 20% is that one-fifth that Joseph had told the king. So it would be necessary to level a double tithe on the produce of Egypt during the years of plenty. It has been shown by historians that tithing was practiced in ancient Egypt and other nations, as a form of taxes, a tribute to the king. But a 20% levy would be very unusual and might well be resisted, especially if enacted by an unpopular sovereign. So what I'm saying is, as he went through Egypt, he'd go to all these cities and he was organizing, setting everything up, getting ready for the famine. He would have to double the tax that people normally pay in order to get all the grain in. And they didn't pay in money, they paid in food. And so they would have to take 20% of the food instead of 10% was the normal tax. They'd have to take double that in order to have enough food, grain, and so forth to make it through the 7 years of famine. Now, if you were a foreigner and you were going around, you were telling people that you're going to have to pay double your tax for 7 years. You think they can't take that kindly? If they didn't like the guy, they might revolt. So right off at the start, this gives us a hint of what all was going on. And yet God used Joseph in every perspective. Even his pride, I don't know what he looked like, but I wouldn't suppose that he looked like a curmudgeon or something, or somebody that's, he looked sophisticated. He looked confident. He was not condescending to people. All these things had to come into play for all this to work. And so when he says it went on throughout Egypt, that's what he was doing, setting all this up. And there's no record of anybody that were protesting or arguing about double the tax. Because one main reason is because Joseph was God's man and God was opening the doors for him. In Genesis chapter 47, verse 24, it says, "And the harvest you shall give a fifth to Pharaoh, and four-fifths shall be your own for seed of the field, and for your food, and for your houses, and for your food for your little ones." So you see that. How would you like to be a foreigner? Now you have the highest responsibility in Egypt above everyone else, and you have this task, and you got to go out, and the first thing that you have to start doing is raising their taxes, doubling it. Some people at that point, using my old construction verbiage, some people would drag up. John knows what I'm talking about. They would quit. They said, "No, here I am. They don't know me. I'm not even their race. I'm not even part of them. And I got to double the taxes." I just thought I would throw that in to show you how God was in every little bitty aspect of everything that needed to be done. God was taking care of it. And Joseph was doing his part. So let's look at 47 through 49. "And during the 7 years of plenty, the land brought forth abundantly. So he gathered all the food in these 7 years which occurred in the land of Egypt, and placed the food in the cities and the places in every city, food from its own surrounding fields. Thus Joseph stored up grain in abundance, great abundance, like the sand of the sea, until he stopped measuring it, for it was beyond measure." Verse 50. "Now before the year of famine came, two sons were born to Joseph, whom Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, bore him." In verse 51, "And Joseph named the firstborn Manasseh, for he said, 'God has made me forget all my trouble and all my father's household.'" So when we get to verse 50, oh, one other thing I was going to say. The sovereignty of God was manifested in Joseph in interpreting the dream and the plan that followed about the one-fifth and what all needed to be done. That came from God as well. They revealed the complete power and control of God over all creation. And Pharaoh was just a bystander that got to see the power and omniscience and omnipotence of God in action. So here you have the highest person in the land. He was like a god. He could do anything. And he didn't have a Congress. He was the king. And yet he had to get on the sidelines and watch God work in order to save his people and his country. What do you think he thought about that? He thought very highly of Joseph, and he thought very highly of Joseph's God as well. So, now, in verse 50 and through 52, God blesses Joseph even more by giving him the gift of two sons. He's already given him, he had everything he could possibly want. Now he has a wife. He's number two, and people are bowing down to him, all these type of things. And he gets two of the best gifts someone can receive. And according to Psalm 127, verse 3, "Behold, children are a gift of the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward." Joseph didn't have to face this alone. He had a wife, and she bore him children. The birth of children and good crops are marks of divine blessing in the Old Testament. They didn't go by money. They went by how many flocks you have and how much crops you have and so forth. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22 through 23 says, Lamentations 3, 22 through 23, "The Lord's loving kindness indeed never cease, for his compassions fail not. They are new every morning, and great is thy faithfulness." You know, I might take that verse and put it by the bed, so when I wake up, that's the first thing I see. That'd be a good idea, wouldn't it? Now this, after all the undeserved suffering, but God never left him. God was always in the background working and having things come about to where his will is going to be done. And all this is going to save his people. The names of both Joseph's sons praise and thank God. The other one, I'll go ahead and read it, verse 52. And the second one, "And he named the second Ephraim, for he said, God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction." Both of them he named in a way that was thanking God, one for his perseverance and for his blessing. Now I want you to notice that Joseph did not give them Egyptian names. They did everything they could to Egyptianize them. He was still a Hebrew, and he still thought about his family. So Manasseh, whose name means "he who causes to forget." You need to make sure you've got that one. Because Manasseh says, "For he said, God has made me forget all my trouble and all my father's household." Now I have to make sure you understand that is not to be taken literally. He did not forget about all his suffering, and he did not forget about his family. Forget does not mean loss of memory about his adversities related to his brother selling him into slavery, but rather it means the hurt or the sting of those adversities was gone from his memory. He still remembered what happened, but they didn't sting anymore. There was not the pain there anymore. That's what that means. Because God had wiped him away because he blessed him to that extent. In fact, the mere mention of his father's household reveals that Joseph had not forgotten his father and his brothers. That has something to say to us, doesn't it? What does time do to a wound? I'm talking about inside you wound. It mitigates it, doesn't it? It lessens it. They say time is the great healer. But that's only for those who have not created a grudge. You see, if you forgive people and you're depending on God, you'll still have the memories of things that were unpleasant. But the rage and the pain and all that will be removed. Isn't it great to remember things without getting angry, without being upset about it? Well, that's what it's talking about. So I hope you put something in your Bible here where it says, God made me forget my trouble and all my father's household. He would never forget them. He's talking about the loneliness and how much harder it was for him for 13 years away from his family, not knowing anything about them, and all the horrible things that were done to him. He could think on them and not get angry, not want to have revenge or have self-pity. Verse 52, I only have time to finish this one right here. And he named the second Ephraim, for he said, God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction. Now, the son named Ephraim, the name Ephraim means fruitful. Joseph recognized that God never abandoned him and turned his undeserved suffering into abundant blessing. That's what that's talking about. This is what happens when you wait on the Lord. It always turns out well. It might not be on your timetable or my timetable, but it's coming. You have to trust the Lord enough through all the things that happen. And when you get discouraging news, when you get bad news, that you just feel undone, and you were counting on this so much, and now it's gone, and you just want to be angry, and you want to have self-pity, and you want to just, you want to do something, because you're trying to get rid of the pain. Well, God takes care of that pain over time, to where you can look back in your life and recognize things where you suffered undeservedly and not be angry, because you're learning through those things. And now the payday has come. God has a payday for those who wait on Him. And coming from me, probably the most impatient person in Texas, maybe not the whole United States, but probably in Texas, that's saying a lot. And I have learned to some degree to wait on the Lord. We all need to do that. When things don't get better and you're praying, you're doing everything you can, you're thinking, what else can I do? Just keep waiting. You're on the Lord's timetable, not yours and not mine. And you know what it takes to have that power to wait without getting into mental attitude sins? Faith. You got to believe God is going to come through. Joseph recognized that God never abandoned him, and God turned his undeserved suffering into abundant blessing. Psalm 147:3 says, He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Are you ready for the next time that you are suffering undeserved? Will you remember Joseph? Are you willing to wait on the Lord and not try to take it into your own hands? How long can you wait? Are you thinking as long as it takes? That's the right answer. How many of you want to wait? None of us want to wait. We want it right now, but we have to go through time and this suffering, develop us spiritually so God can do what he wants to with us, so we'll have great impact in the angelic conflict. We need to think those thoughts whenever the next time rolls around, which might not be long. We might not get home before we are going to be suffering undeservedly. I hope that what we've done with Joseph so far by seeing what God has in his word will help us to shut down the human viewpoint, shut down the emotions and the anger and the grinding of teeth and the revenge and all the things that take place when you just, it's not right. There's a calmness that can come over you when you start thinking about the Lord and you pour your soul out to the Lord. And you depend on him and wait and watch the wonderful things that will come to pass. If you're not a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, then these last few words that I'm going to say today are going to be the most important words that you've ever heard up to this point, if you've never heard the gospel. The good news is that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, did go to the cross. He died on that cross for your sins and my sins, for the sins of the entire world. And as he hung on that cross, he said, "It is finished. The payment for your sin has been paid." He was buried, rose from the grave, and now offers eternal life to anyone who will trust him and him alone for it. You see, it's faith, that one act of faith in Jesus Christ, that now your sin is paid for. The only issue now is, are you going to take the free gift of eternal life by receiving it? And the way you receive it is to believe in Jesus Christ and his work on the cross. In that moment, you become a royal family member of the Most High. You don't have to worry about where you're going. You're going to be in heaven. And now you have the high honor to represent the Lord Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You have that honor. But like Joseph, you need to develop spiritually. And as you go through life and you see all these things happen and you throw your burden on the Lord and watch him work for you, it only makes you love him more and be in awe of what he's already done and what he's going to do. So I would suggest that you don't put that off, that you do it today. Let's close. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for this part of Genesis with Joseph. We don't know how he suffered. A dungeon, an ancient dungeon, the smells, the rats, the slop for food, day after day, year after year. But you reveal this to us in your word, that Joseph went through all of that, continued to trust in you, and now we can look back and see how wonderful you are that you used a person like Joseph to save your people. And you can do the same for us. So we pray that whenever we get kicked in the teeth by life, that we won't get angry and be in a rage and want to go our own way, but we'll just wait and trust in you and see the phenomenal things that you have in store for us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.